Hello, the last Thor survivors. Let's see, I hit the zero in scan this morning, so we're still doing a million times better than zero. No, infinitely better than zero here. Anyway, I think it's a mixture between deadlines and YouTube. I hope. At least that's what I hope. Good, so today we continue in frequentist statistics and are concerned with confidence intervals today, so a classical topic in frequentist statistics. So this is again the overview about frequentist statistics that I showed when we first went into frequentist statistics, and we have now discussed parameter estimation to some depth. Of course, we focused on maximum likelihood estimation and the properties of maximum likelihood estimators that then follow, where we've looked at finite, sample, and infinite sample, or sample size going to infinity over the last two sessions. And this was essentially it in terms of parameter estimation in the frequentist setting. So the remaining topics in frequentist statistics are confidence intervals, which is the topic for today, and hypothesis testing, which is the topic then for next time. And then in the week before Christmas, we're going to discuss some non-parametric statistics, which is also, which we mainly also look at from a frequentist perspective, but it's not the classical parametric frequentist statistics anymore. So confidence intervals, that's the topic today. And as before, in frequentist statistics, we are interested in distributions of functions of the data. So I changed the original slide here a little bit and put statistics and instead of estimators. So the difference between estimators and statistics in this general setting is that estimators map into the parameter space because they're trying to estimate parameters, while statistics not necessarily do so. If you think about the t-statistic in a GLM, of course, that doesn't map into parameter space, but into one-dimensional space. Good, so confidence intervals, that's the topic. And of course, the idea a little bit about confidence intervals is to get some sort of interval estimate that is associated with some probability. And somehow this probability has to do with the true but unknown parameter. So we are going away from a pure point estimation where the true but unknown parameter is a single real number, and we are trying to estimate this with a single real number or real number parameter vector. And we know that the estimate that we have is most likely wrong because the probability assigned to any real number is zero in the continuous case. So we're trying to basically be a little bit more imprecise. This is also what's shown here, be a little bit more imprecise with our estimate. And instead of saying, okay, the value is 2.1477 something, we say, okay, the value is roughly in an interval between 2.0 and 2.2. So we are not quite as precise as previously, but we can give a probability condition to the interval. So we are basically making less precise estimates, but with higher probability of them being in some form correct, because with the point estimate we are most likely wrong, but we are also very precise. Now we are trying to do to be a little less precise, but also be a bit more confident in our estimate. And of course, this kind of these probability statements that will come up here are again probability statements on the background of frequentist statistics. So we are not forming any posterior distributions about parameters or something, but we again base the probabilistic machinery on the sampling intuition, where we have data that is distributed according to some parametric model with a PDF. We have in real life, we have one observation, so no distribution or anything. We have one observation, but we can, from the architecture of the model, think that we can hypothetically sample many data sets, and for each of these data sets evaluate our statistic, and then somehow do something with the distribution of this statistic to get to these interval estimates. And how we get them, this is of course the topic here. But again, these intervals that we will discuss, they have a distribution, or there's a let's say they have a distribution, or they have a probability to contain the true but unknown parameter, but in a frequentist setting, in the setting of sampling from the data. And this is what we want to clarify and look into a little bit in more detail today. So this is where this stuff is coming from. So you find confidence intervals in all statistical data analysis books that discuss the frequentist framework. You of course have seen, so who has studied confidence intervals in undergrad statistics? I guess, so it's a typical, definitely in psychology, a typical topic. It's also a typical topic in mathematical statistics. And of course, it's also, if you ever analyzed data and you had you computed some averages, you usually want to give some error bars, and then you have many, you have a number of options. So what you can do is to, as error bars, use the standard deviation, or you use the standard error of the mean to, so if you use the standard deviation, that would be to indicate the variability of the data in, that you have observed. If you use the standard error of the mean, that would be to say something about your certainty in the mean estimate. And then one option is also to plot confidence intervals to basically give a confidence interval. Usually people prefer the one that comes out with the smallest error bars, which is usually the standard error of the mean. So that's why these are usually plotted, but often confidence intervals are then also written up in the text and provided. And as we will see after hypothesis testing, under certain conditions and so on, confidence intervals are equivalent to hypothesis tests. We will look at that in some detail at the end of next session. So if you, in a way, feel that the community that you're communicating your results to, whether that's in academia or in industry, that this community likes hypothesis testing, p-values, you might as well also report confidence intervals, or the other way around, if they like confidence intervals, so then they might also like hypothesis tests and so on. So there are definitely communities that, for example, in the medical community, that expect something like a p-value or confidence interval or hypothesis test. And for these kind of applications, this is why we are doing this, and and which also show that these concepts are prevalent, and you will always find them in books and also in the literature. Who has computed a confidence interval for some data analysis? Who has done hypothesis tests? Good. So
just the fifth command, right? In most hypothesis, and then you get the most.
Of course. Sure. I mean, availability is always an issue, so that that people do it because the software gives it to them and then they report it, that's of course also an issue. Of course the aim here is to understand what this is about and why it may or may not be a good idea to report confidence intervals. I mean, it's definitely a good idea. I think the problem with confidence intervals and hypothesis testing and p-values is more the understanding of this rather than the issues themselves. I mean, they have a specific theory, that's what they do. They don't do more than that, but that's what they do, and we can be happy about it. Good. So so that's the outline. So first, a definition of confidence intervals, because I don't find it that helpful to try to intuitively explain what they mean, but start really with the definition. and then discuss what they intuitively mean in terms of the interpretation. Briefly mention Pivots, then again, we've seen these before, but these are kind of the four statistics or so that basically you come across in classical frequentist statistics, specifically under the assumption of Gaussians all the time. So I mentioned them here again, and if you want to look at examples for confidence intervals, which we then want to do, we need them anyway. So this is kind of the real classical frequentist Gaussian theory, but it helps to clarify the relationships and so on, and so we will discuss them and then immediately apply them in when we talk about exact confidence intervals and also approximate confidence intervals, then based on the Wald statistic. Any questions before we start? Anything to discuss? Good. So, definition. So I'm framing everything here in terms of delta confidence intervals, where delta is a value in the open interval between 0 and 1. So you can always read for delta 95%. Now, so we're talking about 95% confidence intervals. Often in books you also find the 1 minus alpha confidence interval, where alpha is then something like 0.05, which 1 minus alpha is then again 0.95. I find it a little bit easier to talk directly in terms of the size or the probability that we're interested in, so the delta. Also with the 1 minus alpha, it's a little bit confusing regarding the significance levels of tests, which we'll discuss next time. So delta confidence interval, 95% confidence interval, or 0.95 confidence interval. What is a 0.95 or a delta confidence interval? We assume that we have a parametric statistical model. We have a PMF or PDF P theta, and we have a sample, which I write here as X, corresponding to these random variables, which are independent and identically distributed according to P theta. Sometimes I, could you close the door? We don't basically teach to the whole house. Thanks. So the sample here X consisting of these random variables, of course you can also put some brackets around there if you want, but then it's a little bit weird with this. I just need one notation for all the random variables. Just notational issue, but the random variables has always IID. So this is what we have, and then we assume we have two statistics, BLX and BUX, where BL stands for lower boundary, so B for boundary, L for lower, and BU for upper boundary. Our confidence interval is an interval where the lower boundary is given by BL and the upper boundary is given by BU. What you should associate with this is when we talk about an interval, this is of course a subset of some set, and in this case it's of course the set of the real numbers, meaning that what we're talking about here are scalar parameters for which we define confidence intervals. If we have vector valued parameters, then you can of course also specify something like a confidence interval, but this is then better called a confidence set, because intervals are really for the real numbers. Confidence sets, you then have to think about how they extend in the two dimensions of a vector value parameter or more. We are not discussing that, but we are concerned with a scalar parameter, which if it's in a subset, is in an interval. It's of course also a specific set, namely it's a set that is contiguous, so it's not comprising something here and something there in the real numbers, but it's one subset that is connected. Yeah, so it's a it's an interval. I mean, everybody knows what an interval is, but an interval of course doesn't apply in the case of multivariate statistics, multivariate parameters necessary. Good, so that's, we have these two statistics, BLX and BLU, and then a confidence interval is the interval with the lower boundary BL and the upper boundary BU. And now the confidence interval needs to fulfill a certain condition, namely that the probability that the true but unknown value theta is in this interval under the probability associated with this true but unknown parameter is delta. And we can, of course, express the probability that theta is in the confidence interval equivalently in terms of this event, that the lower boundary is equal to or less than theta, and the upper boundary is equal to or less than theta. And this needs to hold for all theta in the parameter space, again, of which again is a subset or maybe even equal to the real numbers. Yeah, so the crucial thing here is that a confidence interval is defined such that the true but unknown parameter is in the confidence interval, or expressed differently, that the confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter, which is the same thing as that the true but unknown parameter is in the interval, with a predefined probability under the true but unknown parameter, and this predefined probability is delta. Yeah? So that's the definition of a delta confidence interval. Delta is then also called the confidence level or the coverage probability. And the important thing, and the, one of the most important thing to always keep in mind when talking about confidence intervals, is what are the random variables and what are constants. The random variables are, of course, the upper and lower boundaries, or lower and upper boundaries, because they are functions of the data. And under frequentist, in the frequentist mindset, the data has a distribution, but the parameter does not. Hence, this probability statement is about, or the thing that has a distribution is the confidence interval, not the parameter. Yeah? And there is a certain probability that the confidence interval covers the parameter, or, and that's the same thing, that the parameter is in the confidence interval, and this is called delta. So this is the crucial thing is to realize that the confidence interval is a random interval. Yeah, so you sample data, you get a realization of a confidence interval. You sample data again, you get a new realization of the confidence interval, and so on, because always these lower and upper boundaries are random variables. Theta, on the other hand, is a fixed, meaning not random, unknown quantity, the true but unknown parameter. Yeah, a delta confidence interval covers two theta with probability delta, that's what this says. Often this delta is 0.95. 95% confidence intervals, and something that we will actually not discuss is confidence intervals with lower boundary minus infinity or upper boundary infinity. One-sided, they're called one-sided confidence intervals. We will not discuss them in any depth. Of course, they are also related to one-sided tests, but yeah, I could have also left that out because we will not discuss that more. So maybe before I ask for questions, now the interpretation of that, so the, what you need to focus on is data has a probability distribution, data can be randomly realized, so can then also be confidence intervals. So what does it mean that we have a 95 confidence interval for some parameter? Here are two interpretations from the Wassermann. First thing is the typical interpretation you also, I guess, learned in psychology, for example. This is the first one. If an experiment is repeated over and over, the delta confidence interval will contain the true but unknown parameter value in delta times 100% of the cases, so 0.95 times 100, so 95% of all cases. More technically, for repeated random samples from a distribution with unknown parameter theta, a delta confidence interval will cover theta in delta times 100% of all cases. it's actually the same. So what Wassermann discusses here is that this of course assumes somehow that you have this experiment and that you can repeat the same experiment with the same true but unknown parameter value again and again. And this is of course in a way an unrealistic assumption, because you usually do an experiment once and you have one fixed true but unknown value, and then this distribution over parameter this distribution over confidence intervals is hypothetical. But Wassermann also gives a second interpretation, which is equally as true and maybe a little bit more intuitive. So here the idea is that there is no need for the parameter to always be the same one, and the experiment being always also the same one and under identical conditions, because irrespective of what the true but unknown parameter is, in 95% of the cases, the confidence interval covers this true but unknown parameter. So even if you allow the true but unknown parameter to vary, so you have a theta 1, you have a theta 2, and so on, and you always for each of these compute a confidence interval, then still in 95% of the cases of these realizations of confidence intervals, the true but unknown parameter value will be in the confidence interval. So this, and this is of course much more related to what you do in real life. You do multiple experiments, and in each experiment, in each study, you compute a confidence interval, and then you can basically be sure that in over the your lifetime of performing experiments, in 95% of the cases, the confidence interval will actually have captured the true but unknown parameter value. And these experiments were not all the same, and the parameters were not all the same. Yeah, so questions about these basic definitions and basic connotations. So apparently confusion always arises a little bit in terms of the probability statement here. You just need to appreciate that under classical frequency statistics, parameters don't have probabilities associated with them, or don't have distributions. Distributions are for data and statistics. Of course, you can have the probability that such a statistic and somehow is in some way is related to the true but unknown true but unknown parameter, which is the case here. But it's of course something different than specifying a probability distribution over the parameter to assume values. Yeah, so that's something to keep separate in your head. And in the Übung, we will see some simulations. So if you simulate this and you fix a true but unknown parameter, and then you simulate, and then you get some data and evaluate confidence intervals, you actually see that in 95% of the cases, if you have a 95% confidence interval, they contain the true but unknown value, and you get even more into the sampling assumption. Good, so if there are no questions about that, then two brief definitions, because these are terms that come up in the discussion of confidence intervals, namely of pivots, the notion of an exact pivot and an approximate pivot. An exact pivot is a function of the data, so the random variables representing the data, and the true but unknown parameter theta, with distribution not depending on theta. So this took me some time to appreciate what the point here is. The point is that the function, so how the pivot, so the statistic is defined in terms of the data, may depend on theta. Yeah, so for example, think of, we will see the Z statistic where you subtract the true but unknown parameter, so the function depends on it, but the distribution of it, which will then be the standard normal distribution, does not depend on it. Yeah? So I think the easiest to understand these definitions is then to relate them to examples, which we will do. An approximate pivot is a pivot whose distribution does not asymptotically depend on the two parameter theta. So of course we will, from last time when we used this asymptotic property of maximum likelihood estimators, where we find in the limit of large samples, we get to normal distributions. We will now, of course, use this in the approximate setting. This is just me writing up the thing. Again, pivot is a statistic depending on the true theta with distribution independent of theta. They will be used, and we will see them for constructing confidence intervals. And the nice thing is that they are then valid for all values of theta, because the distribution is independent of theta, so we don't need always a new distribution if we consider another true but unknown parameter value. So that's also the value of these pivots. Pivots also must not depend on nuisance parameters. The nuisance parameter, so these are other parameters that we are currently not interested in, so they cannot, should not depend on them, and the distribution of the pivot must not depend on neither theta or eta. I think that's easiest to appreciate if you look at what the t-statistic actually does, and then this is fairly intuitive because this is just expressing as a general principle what the t-statistic actually does. We will see that in a second. Exact pivots referring to exact confidence intervals, and approximate pivots referring to approximate CIs. We will also see that. Thing is mainly this is a term, that the typical exact and approximate pivots are the t-statistic and the Walsh statistic, and you you just come across this term, and maybe if you're trying to construct a test yourself, you might say, okay, first I need to find a pivot to have a confidence interval that I can use for all true but unknown values, and then depending on the distribution setting that you are in, you can try to find a pivot. And maybe you succeed, maybe not, who knows. Good. So this was already the definition, interpretation, and pivot business. Pivot, again, as a generalization of the principle of a t-statistic or z-statistic, and we would see applications of that latest when we talk about exact confidence intervals. Good. Before we can discuss exemplary confidence intervals and the typical ones that are always discussed, we need to again refresh our knowledge about statistics under the Gaussian distribution, namely the ZU and T statistic, in the Gaussian asymptotic limit, namely the Walsh statistic. One could add here the F statistic, but I didn't. So F statistic could also fall into this zoo of statistics, but these are really statistics that if you ever really do something in frequentist statistics in the classical setting, you will not be able to do it without these statistics, and we've already seen them. So I mentioned them already in when we talked about random variable transformations in a very similar setting. I'm discussing them now. What I needed here was also some notation for what's coming up later. So in a way, this is kind of a repeated definition of ZU and T statistics, maybe with some slight changes in notation, but it's required for the confidence intervals that come next. So let's briefly rehearse this. The Z statistic, what is the Z statistic? We are in the context of normally distributed data according to a univariate normal distribution, a Gaussian distribution with expectation mu and variance parameters equal square, they are ID, and we consider the sample mean. Now we define the Z statistic, and remember, a statistic is just a function of the data. We define the Z statistic as the sample mean minus the true but unknown value multiplied by the square root of the number of data points divided by the standard deviation, so the square root of the variance. So note that for the to evaluate the z-statistic, you need to know the true but unknown value of sigma and the true but unknown value of mu. If you consider for the moment sigma and a nuisance parameter, or you just consider it a known, then the Z statistic is a function of the data and the true but unknown parameter mu. Its distribution, however, does not depend on mu, because this is distributed according to a standard normal distribution. And this means that we have a PDF for it. PDF is the standard normal distribution. And what we will need for the confidence intervals are the CDF and the inverse CDF. This is why they are always shown up here. I didn't write them their full a formula up. I just need some notation for the CDFs and inverse CDFs. And for the CDF here, it's phi, and for the inverse CDF, it's phi to the power of minus one. Now, remember that into the inverse CDF, you put in probabilities and you get out the values for which the random variable has the probability that you put in to be smaller than the value that you get out. Yeah, this is always in confidence in hypothesis testing. You always again, or at least I always need to again think about the CDF, how it looks, and then go either from the statistics outcome space to the CDF value, which is the probability for the random variable to take a value smaller than this. But you can also go the other way around, from some probability just to remind you of CDF and inverse CDF, because this will be this is constantly required in in confidence intervals and hypothesis tests. So you have here probability that the random variable is smaller or equal to x. So here you have x, this goes from 1 to 0, and then, sorry, this is the whole thing, here's x. And then in terms of the CDF, you go here, and you go from here. No, let's do here to here, and you associate, for example, with the value 2 a probability of 0.9 for the random variable to be smaller than 2, and for the inverse CDF, so this would be here, this would be the CDF, and for the inverse CDF, you go from a probability, which I always call in this case Q, you go from here, and assuming that this is an invertible function, which for the case of the stuff that we're looking at it is, you put in a probability and you get back the value that corresponds to the value of the random variable, such that 90% or 0.9 probability of the values of this random variable are lower than this value. Yeah, so that's the CDF business. One always just needs to be clear about it. It's simple, but it can be, in terms of the notation and so on, it's easy to get confused there, at least for me. Yeah, so that was the Z statistic. Then let's look at the U statistic. Also, for how to get to this, I already mentioned earlier, there are proofs in the Casella and Berger. Maybe in future iterations of this course I will include the proofs here, because it's very fundamental and it's interesting, but on the other hand it also takes some time, and if we go about these proofs we might not be able to discuss the confidence intervals. So so here you find proofs. The U statistic, again, we are in the Gaussian scenario. We look at the mean and we look at the unbiased or we look at the sample variance, so sample mean and sample variance. And now we are interested in this statistic, the sample variance, might use an N here, divided by the true but unknown variance and multiplied by N minus 1. This is called the U statistic, and this is distributed according to a chi-square distribution with N minus 1 degrees of freedom. it means it has a PDF, which I give here, and it has a CDF, which I denote by this big C squared, and an inverse CDF, which I denote by this big C squared minus 1. I just needed some notation for these things. Again, you find a proof of this, that this thing here is distributed according to a chi-square distribution, because I'm not there. T-statistic. Here we have the sample mean and we have the sample standard deviation, so the sample variance, the square root of the sample variance, and the t-statistic is then defined as the sample mean minus the true but unknown value divided by the sample standard deviation times the square root of n. And this is distributed according to a t-distribution with n minus, minus 1 degrees of freedom. It means it has a PDF for t, and it also has a CDF, and this CDF I denote here with psi. So in a way I took Greek letters for the CDFs, and kind of for the distribution I took the capital letter, for the PDF I used the lowercase letter, and then Greek letters, arbitrary Greek letters for the CDF and inverse CDF. I tried, so that you can use different iterations, one or different forms. One way also that I use it, one thing that I use at one point is to use for the PDF the small letter, and then for the CDF the small letter with a tilde, and then the tilde with a minus one for the inverse. Yeah, one can also use this. You find actually in statistics books, you often find this phi and psi business. Important thing is, of course, the concept and the idea that this is the inverse CDF of a T distribution, or rather than how it's written. But of course, if you clarify your writing on it, then you also clarify the concept. Sorry, that was the T statistic. And finally, the Walsh statistic. So here we are now not in a necessarily in a Gaussian scenario, and we just consider a maximum likelihood estimator for theta, and we consider its observed Fisher information, and then the Wald statistic is defined as the square root of the observed Fisher information times the maximum likelihood estimator minus the true but unknown value. And we've seen last time that this is asymptotically distributed according to a standard normal distribution. This is about the asymptotic normality of maximum likelihood estimators. You can also put the expected Fisher information here. But this means that for this Wald statistic, we again have what we also have for the Z statistic, namely a standard normal distribution, again with its associated CDF and inverse CDF. Well, so these are the four statistics you should study in some depth, their relationship and their definitions. So one thing is always, so you can go about studying them in different ways. So you can start with the Gaussian definition of maybe the errors when sampling from a univariate Gaussian or something like that, and then think about the transformation that happens if you now compute sample variance and you get to the U statistic, and then the transformation you get if you in addition if you in addition put in the sample mean, how you get then to the T distribution, and then you basically have it. The thing is, you always need to relate the definition of these distributions with the statistics. Yeah. So yeah, maybe I do that at one point in this lecture. It's also something, it's a little bit, it's not tedious, but it's very simple, but one needs to get into it. Yep.
I have a question. So yeah, it's clear, so we assume x1 to xn is distributed to a normally distributed, but we need, so I'm not totally sure, where's the mu coming from? So we don't know this parameter.
Yep.
We don't need to know, right? Or we assume mu, I'm not sure how.
So this is a, so we will see in a way when we, how this is being used. So we will see how this is being used. So today we're talking about confidence intervals, and then we will see that this, when we have the confidence interval, we basically have a formula, and then can say about something about this mu.
I remember.
And so this is what we see. And in terms of hypothesis testing, we of course always have a hypothesis about mu, so that we say, okay, it's zero or it's one or something, and then we use the t-statistic under the assumption, under this null hypothesis assumption. And this, so in this sense, we don't, so we always know it because, yeah, we use it in a certain way.
Yeah.
Other questions about these statistics? So all of them and their distributions, of course, follow from these ideas about random variable transformations. Good. So in the following, we will then always assume that, as we've seen previously, the t-distribution the t-statistic is distributed according to a t-distribution. Things like that will come up. Yeah. Good, but then let's have a break now, because the remaining stuff is fairly, it's always the same thing. It's always developing confidence intervals according to a recipe. And I think that's a nice block, so let's do that after the break if there are no questions right now. Great. So now, after this kind of preliminary discussion of confidence intervals, so the general part and the general stuff on the statistics, let's now look at some real confidence intervals and essentially the construction. So the idea is, because you are a data scientist, that you know how to construct confidence intervals for the parametric statistical models that you develop in your work. So it's not so we are not only aiming for you that you know the typical confidence intervals that arise, but that you also know, in a way, the procedure to develop a confidence interval. Like in maximum likelihood, where you should know the procedure to derive maximum likelihood estimates, here you should know how to develop confidence intervals, and I give some examples, and then with hypothesis testing and so on, you also know how to develop a test. So that's kind of the overarching aim there. So the typical construction then works as follows. So of course you first start with defining a parametric statistical model. Without probabilistic assumptions, nothing will happen. And then you consider a specific statistic and its associated distribution. So in some way you come up with a statistic that you compute from the data, some kind of summary function, and based on the distribution of the data, you think about the distribution of the statistic. And once you have that, you can actually, and we will see this by example, you can do what I call here the verification of the confidence conditions. So you basically check for the probability that the parameter is in a confidence interval, and you make sure that this probability has a certain value. What this means in detail, we'll see by example. And once you have verified this confidence condition, you can formulate the confidence interval, and then you have a formula that you can always, once you have some evaluation of the statistic, always apply, and then always write, so this is our parameter estimate and this is our confidence interval. So that's the procedure, and we will demonstrate this procedure, so these four steps, kind of a recipe, 1, 2, 3, 4. We will demonstrate that for the expectation of a normal distribution with known variance, for the expectation of a normal distribution with unknown variance, the variance of a normal distribution, and then finally, so because we're doing exact confidence intervals here, so these are the three cases where we do exact, and once we've done these three cases, then we will do the approximate confidence interval. Yeah, so it's a procedure, let's look at that now. So it always starts with the distribution, with the definition of the parametric statistical model. So we're looking here at a confidence interval for the expectation of a normal distribution for which the variance is known. So in our parametric statistical model, we assume that the data are distributed according to univariate Gaussian, IID, and we know the variance parameter, the expectation parameter is unknown, and we develop a delta confidence interval for mu. Yeah? So that's the starting point. The statistic we consider is, in this case, the z-statistic. So the z-statistic, as previously defined, the sample mean minus the true but unknown parameter multiplied by the square root of n, so the number of data points divided by the standard deviation. And the point here, and this is again what's stressed here, is that z is a function of the data by means of the sample mean and mu. But its distribution, which we've already also seen here in the standard normal distribution, does not depend on mu, and in this sense it qualifies as a pivot, or this is why it can be called a pivot. Now the crucial thing in, of course, all of these things is of course the definition of the or the establishment of the confidence condition. Because once this is kind of verified and it's clear what the problem, how one can construct such a confidence interval, it's easy to formulate it. So this is then the procedure that is always being used. So you decide on a confidence condition, on a confidence level, this delta, and then you find percentiles of the distribution of the statistic. Such that if the statistic falls between those percentiles, so between the z1 and the z2, there is a probability of delta that it falls in between there. And the way this works is that you work with the inverse CDF, hence all this business about CDFs earlier. You work with the inverse CDF, and you basically try to find percentiles that enclose 95% of the probability. So here you basically, because so there are different ways to do that. One way to do that is to basically leave half of the rest between delta and 1 to the lower end, so 1 minus delta, that's 0.05, for example, divided by 2, that's 0.025. And one half of this, the rest, so the 1 minus delta to the upper half, so here you will have 1 plus delta and then half of it, so that's 97.5%, or 0.97, such that if you subtract from the upper percentile, the lower percentile, in terms of its probability, so 1 plus delta divided by 2 minus 1 minus delta divided by 2, you get delta. Yeah, so you try to find two percentiles that enclose 95% of the probability. That's the starting point. Of course, you do that for a reason. So here's an example, so that you are, because I guess most of you are familiar with these numbers. So if delta is 0.95, then if you look at the value under which 2.5% of standard normal variance fall, it's below minus 1.96. So remember, standard normal is centered on 0. And the value below which 97.5% falls is 1.96. Yeah. In the case of these normal distribution expectation confidence intervals, because the normal distribution and then also later the t-distribution, they are symmetric, you can set actually the z1 to minus z2. You see minus 9.6 and plus 9.6, so you can actually get away with a single of these percentiles. Then you want to basically ensure the confidence condition, meaning that the statistic of interest to fall between these percentiles, so the minus z2 and the plus z2, where I set z1 to minus z2, to be delta. And based on this, you can then construct the confidence interval, and this is what's shown here. So you start with that you know that the probability for the z-statistic to fall in this interval from minus z2 to z2, so from minus 1.96 to plus 1.96 in the case of a delta of 0.95, you know that this probability is delta, and you know that the z-statistic is defined like that. Now you want to find an interval that encloses the true but unknown value, so you want to get somewhere here. Yeah. So here you have then this lower boundary and this upper boundary. And you have the probability that the true but unknown parameter is larger or equal than this lower boundary, so this BL x, and it's equal or smaller than this upper boundary, so the BU x. And how do you get there? Well, you just reformulate these inequalities. So this you know based on the definition of the model. And then, yeah, you do your thing. So you multiply by the standard deviation and deviate and divide by the square root of n. Then you subtract the sample mean on both sides. And then you have a minus here, so you multiply everything by minus one, which changes the inequality. And then I think this is a line too many, this I could have gotten rid of. I think, and then it's just reformulated the other way around. So just one line too many. So here it says that mu is larger than this minus this, so that means that mu is larger than this. And then you have yeah, reformulated this, what you knew already, in terms of this lower and upper boundary. Yeah. So where this is getting to, of course, just to show that, is a formulation like this. Yeah. And then you can already specify the confidence interval, namely, oops, this is variance unknown, there. With a known variance parameter and expectation parameter mu, some delta, and one of these percentiles where you only need one, you set the confidence interval to be the sample mean minus the true but unknown standard deviation divided by square root of n times the z delta. The z delta which you choose based on your delta confidence level. And based on the verification of what we've seen above, this confidence interval then covers the true but unknown parameter in delta times 100% of the cases. Yeah? Because essentially this whole thing just works because you start with these percentiles that enclose 95%. You then know that the z-statistic encloses 95%, and then you reformulate this, so you basically isolate the true but unknown parameter in the z-statistic. And then you can state that this interval here contains the true but unknown parameter with a probability of 0.95, because this will be shown on the other, on the side before. I mean, one could also present this as a proof, so you could also say we formulate this confidence interval and then we prove it's true, it's equally as well. I chose this, don't know, this is how I saw it in the books, and then I didn't reformulate much of it. But again, the procedures, write down the statistical model, write down the statistics you're interested in. You have the distribution of the statistics, so you can ensure this 95% condition, and then you need to reformulate that, and then you have the confidence. No? So maybe let me show you one more example, and then we can ask for questions. So this was for the normal distribution if the variance is known. Now we do the same thing again, but under the assumption that the variance parameter is not known. So we have again normally distributed data, and now we develop a delta confidence interval again for mu, but now under the assumption that sigma squared is unknown. And because sigma square is unknown, we can of course not set out with this z statistic anymore, so that we don't know mu. That was not the problem, because we develop a confidence interval for mu. But if we don't know the variance, we cannot evaluate this, so we cannot evaluate the z statistic fully. So we need the t statistic. Yeah. So we start out with the t statistic. With again the sample mean and the sample standard deviation. Now the t-statistic is a function of the data, by means of the sample mean and the standard deviation, but its distribution does not depend on either mu or sigma square, because it just depends on the degrees of freedom. Yeah, so the t-distribution just depends on the degrees of freedom, obviously. The sigma square here is what is earlier referred to as a nuisance parameter, which the statistic itself is not allowed to depend on, and it doesn't, because it depends on the sample standard deviation, but not on the true but unknown value. And its distribution also doesn't depend on it, because it only depends on degrees of freedom. So the t-statistic is an exact pivot, and it's also the condition for pivot with in terms of the nuisance parameters also fulfilled. That's actually quite interesting about the t-statistic, because it's a function, obviously, of the data, and the data depend, of course, on the true but unknown parameters, but this statistic is such that its distribution is independent of how large the data was and how what the expected value was, you don't need to know the true but unknown variance parameter, and still this is independent. It's kind of a very special case. There is no guarantee that these kind of pivots exist in general models, so it's a little bit it's quite interesting. So how then to ensure the confidence condition? Again, that works very much the same, now not with the standard normal distribution, but with the t distribution. You choose the percentiles such that of the t distribution, such that 95% of the probability mass is enclosed by the lower and upper percentiles, exactly like before. And here is an example for n equals 10, and again a delta of 0.95. In this case, then with 9 degrees of freedom, remember earlier we saw the minus 1.96 for the t distribution, and this value gets larger, so you have minus 2.26, and the upper would be 2.26. Again, it's symmetric, also not always the case, but in this case it is. And then again, you know that the probability for the t-statistic to fall between these two things is delta. And then you can again reformulate, and again I have one line too many. So you put in the t-statistic, and then you reformulate, put things on the other side, and end up with a probability of 0.95 for the sample mean minus the sample standard deviation divided by the square root of n times t2 being smaller or equal to mu, and at the same time the sample mean being plus this being larger than mu, and this probability is delta. Yeah, so the logic is exactly the same as for the z statistics. You reformulate this. And then again, you can specify the confidence interval as this interval, and you know, because of this confidence condition that you established previously, that the probability for mu to be in this confidence interval is delta. Yeah, again, because these two are random, the confidence interval is random. Good. Questions about these first two confidence intervals that we now looked at? So you can basically, like you of course did that previously, if you want to evaluate the confidence interval for the true but unknown parameter, compute the sample mean, you compute the standard deviation, you look up the respective t distribution percentile. Of course, you can do that based on the INDIS CDF, and then you can give a 95% confidence interval, and you can say 95% of the cases, and this is of course the point here, if you compute it like this, you obviously compute, you don't need to know the true but unknown value, but you can state that in 95% of the cases that I compute this confidence interval based on some data, the true but unknown value is in there. Yeah. So you have 95%, you have in a frequent test, so you have a frequentist belief, if you want, a frequentist belief that the true but unknown parameter is between essentially twice the standard deviation divided by a square root of n around your sample mean. Yeah? Good. Last exact example here is now we are considering the Gaussian again with an unknown variance parameter, and whether we know mu or not, that doesn't matter. Now the aim is to develop a delta confidence interval for the variance parameter. Yeah, so the difference is not to talk about a confidence interval for the expectation, but now for the variance. And here it makes sense to use the U statistic. So we are considering the U statistic with the sample variance, and we know that this U statistic is chi-square distributed with n minus degrees of freedom. It is a function of the data, but again, its distribution does not depend on the true but unknown value, because the chi-square distribution just depends on the degrees of freedom parameter. And then we can do the same thing again. So here it's again using this idea that you have the half of the one minus delta at the lower end and the other half at the upper end. And then again, so you start with this confidence verification here, and this is one thing that I want to stress, which you can also see from these numbers. The chi-square distribution is not symmetric. Yeah, so the chi-square distribution depends, of course, on the degrees of freedom, but in general, it looks a little bit like this. And if you now look for these things where you have 0.025 of the probability mass above it and below it, so this would be here your C1 and C2, then it's not immediately clear, and this is also a point here, how you should choose these, fill this here, this C1 and C2, because you can do many things. So you can put them here, or you can shift them a little bit to the left or a little bit to the right. In terms of the Z, and the standard normal, it's fairly intuitive because they are symmetric, that one puts this confidence interval symmetric about the expectation of these distributions. So, that's quite nice. So that you put them in a symmetric manner, because they are because you cannot basically not do anything else. So if you can also put them non-symmetric. So what I'm trying to say is that the symmetry condition that is always associated with this expectation confidence intervals for Gaussian distributions is not in the confidence interval framework per se, and confidence intervals are also not uniquely specified, because they just say it needs to cover it with 95%. But then you might say, yeah, but these 95%, I can choose at different parts. So essentially, to specify confidence intervals uniquely, you need some further constraints that you, I don't know, you need to say something that if you go half the confidence interval, that you then, like here, have half of the 95%, so that one half of the confidence interval covers 0.95 divided by 2 or something like this. Of course, you can also do something like this, but this in this case, but this then depends on where you put your boundaries. So here, I just, these things are just made up so that 95% are covered, but you could also find a different way to cover 95%. Yeah, this is just something to realize. But then the logic is of course the same. You know that you cover 95%, and you can reformulate the U statistic so that you enclose the variance parameter in this case, and then you find that if you set the lower boundary to n minus 1 times s square divided by your C2, and so your upper, makes sense, your upper can make, doesn't make sense, let me check here, I guess it makes sense, and your lower boundary, then you get delta. Then you can again formulate a confidence interval. Yeah, so you can also specify confidence, so if you estimate the variance of a of your data, you can also specify confidence intervals for your variance parameter, not only for the expectation parameter. You have 95% of covering the true but unknown parameter value, but you can put these 95% essentially a little bit where you want. And the symmetry condition that's always so prevalent in the basic confidence intervals for expectation parameters is just one way to do it. Yeah. Good, so these were the typical three confidence intervals that you always encounter. Expectation under variance known, using the Z statistic, expectation under variance unknown, using T statistic, and as a kind of funky example, confidence interval for the variance parameter. Now, the last thing I want to discuss is approximate confidence intervals for maximum likelihood estimators, because these are then confidence intervals that you can always use if you use maximum likelihood estimation. These you can, so what we've seen so far, you can use if you have Gaussian distributed data, or you make this assumption, and then you can use them. But you can do a little bit more if you use maximum likelihood. Any questions so far at this point? No. So the way to construct this is of course the same, but now it's of course much more general because it just refers to maximum likelihood estimators. So we will find a formula that, for example, if you have your, you build some kind of model, let's say, because we are doing this of course in computational cognitive neuroscience, you build a model for some behavioral data and you fit this by maximum likelihood. And without now studying anything about the distributions, you can give confidence intervals for your parameter estimates, which is of course nice because you can, with some, with 95% probability, you can say that the true but unknown parameter is covered by these confidence intervals. So you get a formula that even if you do some numerical maximum likelihood estimation, you can apply to your parameter estimates. And this is, of course, fairly general because it applies to all maximum likelihood estimates. And it's, well, it's, it was not quite true. I mean, with the formula, it's not quite true. It's completely free of the distribution. You need to still compute a little bit because it's based on the wild statistic and you need to know the fish information. So it's not, so you still need to do a little bit, but the general formula is free of the Gaussian assumption, but then the general formula involves the fish information, which you can of course compute based on the likelihood function. So what do I mean? So we are now talking about evaluating a confidence interval, and we will see the same thing for a hypothesis test next time, for a parametric statistical model, which is distributed with respect to one scalar parameter. And now we're using the Wald statistic, which is given by the maximum likelihood estimate, the true but unknown parameter, and the Fisher information, the observed Fisher information at the location of the maximum likelihood, which is something that you know, because you did the maximum likelihood estimation. So you know the value of the maximum likelihood estimator. We from the asymptotic theory that we developed last time, we know that this Wald statistic is asymptotically normally distributed. So we can of course use again percentiles of the standard normal distribution to construct a confidence interval for the Wald statistic, which is of course very much very related to what we've seen for the case of the Gaussian with the variance norm. So the construction of the confidence interval in general is then fairly similar. So again, here the Wald statistic is a function of the data and the true but unknown parameter, but its asymptotic distribution does not depend on the true but unknown parameter, so it's an approximate table. This is also why I, of course, while we looked into the asymptotic distribution of maximum likelihood estimates last time quite extensively, so that we have the necessary background to talk about approximate confidence intervals and then and based on Wald statistics, and next time then also can talk about the Wald test. So the confidence condition to establish this, that's easy because that's the same thing as for the standard normal distribution, and again you enclose 95% of the probability by means of the percentiles, and of course for an example you get the, exactly the same numbers. Then of course now, well, let's have a look a little bit closer. Then you know that the Wald statistic falls between these percentiles, the Z2, minus Z2 and Z2. And then again, you start by reformulating this. So you take the square root of the observed Fisher information away from the middle here and put it onto the side. So you again isolate the true but unknown parameter here in the middle. Oops, there's still a typo. This is of course to be a theta. That's my copy and pasting stuff. And you basically then get the confidence interval boundaries, the lower boundary being the maximum likelihood estimator minus the inverse of the square root of the observed Fisher information times the percentile, and as the upper boundary, the maximum likelihood estimate plus the inverse. So this is fairly similar to, of course, the case of the standard normal distribution in the Gaussian expectation parameter confidence interval with known variance. So we then have this general formula for a confidence interval for maximum likelihood estimators. So whenever we do maximum likelihood estimation, we can use this confidence interval. The problem or the trick, and where it's not, where it's still, you need to still do some analytical stuff, is of course is that you here have the observed Fisher information and the square root of it and the inverse of it in this confidence interval. So, and it's an approximate confidence interval only because it only holds in the limit of large data, because the distribution of the maximum likelihood estimator essentially according to a normal distribution only holds in the limit of many data points, big data, the limit of big data. So that's the general formula. To derive the general formula is fairly straightforward if you appreciate that how the Wald statistic is. Thing is, now if we have a concrete scenario, what's going on with this observed Fisher information? And that's then the last example. So here the idea is that we look at the Bernoulli distribution and use want to construct a max an approximate confidence interval for the maximum likelihood estimator. Questions about this approximate confidence interval at this point? No? Good. So that's now the concrete example. We have the maximum likelihood estimator for the mu, which is the probability to observe a 1. The maximum likelihood estimator is just the sample mean. We've seen that previously. And then the result here is, and this, there will be a proof on the next couple of slides, the result is that we have a 95% confidence interval by taking the maximum likelihood estimate, so the sum of the realizations divided by n, minus 1.96, and then we have this formula here, the square root of the maximum likelihood estimator times 1 minus the maximum likelihood estimator divided by n. The reason why this comes up is because the Fisher information, the observed Fisher information in the case of a Bernoulli random sample is given by n over the maximum likelihood estimator times 1 minus the maximum likelihood estimator, and then the inverse and the square root of that is given by this. So if you take this to the power of minus 1/2, then you get this. Then of course the question is, where does this come from? And this this is then the thing that you where you still need to compute things. The question is, what is the Fisher information? And I think today in the Übung we will definitely also compute the Fisher information for univariate Gaussian, maybe not for the multivariate Gaussian. That was a little bit over-optimistic. But for the univariate Gaussian, it's fairly straightforward. And for the Bernoulli, here is also fairly straightforward. So remember, Fisher information defined as the negative second derivative of the log likelihood function. Well, if you look at the log likelihood function of a Bernoulli random variable, you get to these familiar terms. So always start again with the Bernoulli probability mass function, mu to the power of x times 1 minus mu to the power of 1 minus x. Take the logarithm, take the second derivative, then you get to the Fisher information and you get this formula from it. And it's not right. Helps to talk about it because here I'm obviously using the expected Fisher information now and not the Fisher information like I put in on all the previous slides. And we need to use the expected Fisher information because we need to get rid of this x. So the thing is with the Wald statistic, the Wald statistic actually sounds like a cheap Ausrede, but it's actually true. The Wald statistic exists in the different scenarios using the observed Fisher information and the expected Fisher information. It always works. Really. Maybe I should have used expected Fisher information all the time on the slides previously, but it works also for the other cases that I have in there previously. But I think I will change that to always in this, where we're only focusing on one approximate confidence interval and we're focusing on one Wald statistic. It would be much more appropriate to use the expected Fisher information because in this example we finally use the expected information, Fisher information. So to evaluate the expected Fisher information, then we compute the expectation of the Fisher information. So we need the expectation of this and of the Fisher information, and then we get to the expected Fisher information, and then we need the observed expected Fisher information. So this is one needs to keep a little bit track there. In this case, the expected Fisher information is still a function of the true but unknown parameter, and we don't know that, but we have an estimate for it. And the expected Fisher information evaluated at mu is this, and if we evaluate it at the maximum likelihood estimate, we get to that. So the if you want, the typo in the previous slides was that I always talked about the observed fish information, where I should have talked about the expected fish information to have it coherent with the example. However, it also works, the whole thing also works with the observed fish information, not the expected fish information. The thing is, the expected fish information is usually simpler. So here the fish information depends explicitly on the sample, and you can get rid of this sample dependence by looking at the expected fish information, and even the formula gets simpler. And then you get to this, but this should be now really be a J, sorry. So let's put a J there. Yeah, it's almost unnoticeable. Good. So that is how you can construct approximate confidence intervals, but you need to evaluate the expected fish information. Yeah, exciting, right? And well, confidence intervals exist. I don't think that you can ignore them. I mean, it's not the most, you don't have pretty pictures and it's big data and so on, but I mean, look into the medical literature, look into the psychological literature, confidence intervals are everywhere. And of course, people argue, and this is what we will also see the next time we will talk about hypothesis tests, that instead of doing hypothesis tests, it's better to provide confidence intervals. It's essentially the same thing, so I don't think it's better or worse, because they can be equivalent. But it exists, and you need to know what it is about, in my opinion. Yeah? Any questions? Sorry for the confusion with the expected, non-expected, but these are the things that are bound to go wrong on the first iteration of the course, and so they did. Yeah, good. So if there's nothing else, then next time, hypothesis test, which is kind of this now from the other side of the coin. Good. Then see you in a bit in the Übung.